I just spoke with a family and had prayer a few moments ago, and I said this, and I'll say it again, that a week ago, this would have been unimaginable. We love this family, and I know that you are here because you love them as well. And today, this is a service to celebrate life. Life is a very precious gift. Oftentimes, we don't think about how special that gift is until there's something that jeopardizes that or takes it away. But it's not the volume of the amount or length of days that matter, it's what we do with those days. And Nate Hurle was blessed to do so much in the course of his life. And so today we do celebrate by faith the promises of God's word, those that he loved within his family, and the promises such as to all of his children, the words of Christ, I am the resurrection and the life. Whosoever shall believe in me shall never die, but yet they shall live. The book of Job, chapter 19 says, I know that my Redeemer lives, and in that end he will stand on earth. After my body is defeated, yet my body shall see God. I want to thank you for being here. The family appreciates this, and we offer our opportunity time as we gather to celebrate his life. At this time, I'm going to ask for Ship Collins to come. Ship is our youth minister here at First Baptist Church of Greater Cleveland, and he'll have the invocation.
So many memories in this room. And with that, the family has asked that inside the program is an opportunity for you to share as many memories of Nate as you can think of. And there is an opportunity in the back of the sanctuary. There's a basket labeled Memories of Nate. Please place those memories inside. We thank you for that. As we begin the service, I ask that you bow your heads. Dear God, we open this homegoing service with a sincere plea for your strengthening. Lord, let your presence manifest in this place. As we gather here to mourn our beloved Nate, may you bring healing into our hearts. Father, remind us as we gather for this memorial that none of us lives to himself and none of us dies to himself. We are yours, whether we are living in this life or whether we have passed into the life beyond. God, we thank you for your deep, immeasurable love. We thank you for your love that covers us in its fullness, leading us homeward to our glorious rest above. Holy Spirit, take full control and help us to do this as unto God and not unto ourselves. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen.
Skylar, Sierra, and Kyron asked me to share that this song is important to the family because this is the song that Nate was listening to when he truly was saved by the Lord. Before this day, Nate thought the Lord was real, but after this day, Nate knew that one day he was going to be in heaven with the Lord. Thank you.
Who am I that the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurt? Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way for my ever-wandering heart? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling. Lord, you catch me when I'm falling, and you told me who I am. I am yours. Who am I that the eyes that see my sin would look on me with love and watch me rise again? Who am I that the voice that calmed the seas would call out through the rain and calm the storm in me? Because of who you are, not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in because of who you are.
This is a reading from the book of Revelations. Chapter 21, verse 4 says, "He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away." God later said, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life. Those who are victorious will inherit all this, and I will be their God, and they will be my children." Nate is a child of the Lord.
I can't help but look at that picture and just see Nate come to life. He had a way about him. He had a smile. He was bright. He had this tremendous sense of humor. He was very compassionate and sincere. He helped any way that he could. I know he was a leader there with the Cleveland Clinic. And even our own congregation, he was active. We have a food bank on the first Saturday of each month with the Greater Cleveland Hunger Program, and we give out fresh produce, and Nate is always willing to be able to help. Another aspect that he blessed our church with is his knowledge related to the COVID-19 vaccine. I'm not sure what he's thinking here with a mask or no mask and all that. He helped with the policies that our church followed and was remarkable and insightful and just a great guy all around. We had coffee several different times together, and I'll tell you the one thing that among all the great accomplishments that he had, and he loved his family, the one thing I think that he probably would say he was the most proud of is to be a dad. His kids meant everything to him. And so as we think about what that means, in fact, the scripture that was just read is a reminder of how our Heavenly Father promises a new beginning, an inheritance where we will be with our Heavenly Father and Heavenly Father will be with the children. In fact, this relationship of God as Father is used over 260 times in Scripture. And when one looks at the relationship of Christ as he connects with people, he did so most commonly in the description of God, this immortal being, this powerful Almighty, that he is relational, that he knows us, that he cares for us, that he's concerned for us. In the book of Romans, we have the same phrase that Paul used where he describes that we have received a spirit of sonship, whereas we cry, Abba, Father. Or in John's gospel that will be read in a few moments in the third chapter, the promise of new birth in Christ. The subject of Father, sometimes for God, conjures different thoughts and feelings based upon your own relationship with your Father. But what we find within Scripture is that God is described as a good Father. In Luke 15, God the Father is imagined here and described by Christ as the one who embraces the prodigal son after his failures. It's the Father in Matthew chapter 10 who provides and cares for his children, even beyond that which we can comprehend. For the Father's love is special and unique, and God's love is the most powerful of all. Now, I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, wait a second now, Pastor Burris, Reverend Dr. Burris. If God is so loving, so compassionate, why could he allow someone to be stricken in the midst of their life such as this? This is not the first time someone has asked me that question. In fact, it's one of the age-old questions that all of us wrestle with. How could a loving God allow these things to take place, tragedies and untimely demises? I have learned that that's not the right question to ask. We'll never maybe understand the why, because who can understand fully the mind of God? Now, granted, we may put a couple thoughts together and say, well, I know if God did this for this or that. The question to be asked, though, is this, and that is, who? Who is taking care of us? For you see, as followers of Christ, we don't believe that this is the end. In the same way, at the core of our faith, we believe in one who went through a demise of suffering and death, but it didn't end on Friday. The basis of our faith is Sunday morning, Easter, the first day of the week, the resurrection. And this is the promise we have, that even as it scribes in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, 6 through 8, therefore we are confident always knowing that as long as I'm at home in this body, we are away from the Lord. For we live by faith, not by sight. We are confident, I say, and would prefer to be away from the body and to be at home with the Lord. For the promise of God is to watch over his children on this earth and to watch over and take care of his children in his heavenly home. The beauty of that promise is that which provides a celebration, not just of the work and the legacy of a life and the preciousness and the uniqueness of a life, but it's that hope and the promise that our Creator God is also the one who provides a life beyond which we can see, a life that we trust and we believe in the promises of faith. Last week when I was called to be with the family, we had a word of prayer in the hospital as everyone gathered. And I was trying to think what scripture verse would be best to share with the family. And there was just one. And many of you have heard this, and maybe you know it and have memorized. It's the 23rd Psalm. Let's think about that promise. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And you know how it ends? If you know it, would you say it with me? And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The who is our God, who loves him and will take care of him. For you see, love never ends. Love is eternal. Nate loves you, and that love will never stop. The description of a new heaven and a new earth is a promise that God will take care of those that have put their faith and their trust in him. It's a time of joy. It's a time of comfort. It's a time of reunion. There's a famous quote by Ralph Waldo Emerson that says, "This is my wish for you, comfort on difficult days, smiles when sadness intrudes, rainbows to follow the clouds, laughter to kiss your lips, sunsets to warm your heart, hugs when spirits sag, beauty for your eyes to see, friendships to brighten your being, faith so that you can believe, confidence for when you doubt, courage to know yourself, patience to accept the truth, and love to complete your life. It is the blessed promises we have in Christ, the resurrected Christ, who provides that comfort that we know to be absent from this body is to be present with the Lord. And it's this, as life is celebrated and the promise of eternal life. Let us pray. Father God, I pray that the words that have been shared, the message, might allow each person to take a moment to reflect upon the journey of their life as well. Lord, none of us know the future, but we know the one that is there, the eternal God of past, of present, and the future, the good God who takes care of his children, and even though the circumstances are dark and difficult sometimes, and we may find ourselves in that valley of the shadow of death, we fear not, because you are with us. I pray comfort for this family. I pray guidance for them, that as a good father watches over the children, you will watch over the legacy of love that Nate has for them and for all the projects he's been involved with and the work and co-work of so many, that you'll allow his memory and his way and his voice to continue to be heard as we trust that you will take care of us as we continue and complete the work and ministry you'd have for us. We pray these things in Christ's name.
A reading from John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Although Nate is not living here on earth with us anymore, he is living the most beautiful life in heaven, filled with laughter, jokes, and endless bike rides.
I'm Mike, one of Nathan's brothers. And yes, I know that most of you know him as Nate, or Coach Nate. A select few call him Dad. But to me, he will always be Nathan, my little brother. First, on behalf of my family, I would like to thank everyone for your overwhelming support for Nathan's family. Your care, concern, and countless gestures throughout the week are greatly appreciated. And of course, I'd like to thank Pastor Craig and his entire congregation for opening their home to us. Last month, John and I drove out to Cleveland to be here for Sierra's high school graduation party. We're so glad we made that trip. In addition to having a lot of fun with friends and family on Saturday, we had some time on Sunday to take a long overdue cruise on Nathan's boat, the Lawn Ornament. An apt name for a while, but Nathan and his family have used the boat quite a bit recently, and he was excited to take us out on a cruise. So Nathan, Heather, John, and I ventured out on a somewhat cloudy Sunday afternoon. We had a great tour of the Cleveland waterfront. Nathan was always so proud of his adopted city. He was really happy to show it to us from the water. Before heading back to dock, we had some time to see the sights along the Cuyahoga River. We were having a good time and talked about coming back soon to tour the river at night. Unfortunately, we weren't exactly paying attention to the weather, Next thing we know, we're in the middle of a pretty good downpour. We made it back out to the flats, but the water was getting a bit choppy, visibility dropped, most of us were getting soaked, and there was lightning in the area. There were many other boats close by, so I was getting a little nervous that someone would run into us or a lightning bolt would be directed our way. But Nathan, being the man in charge that we all knew and loved, confidently blurted out, "Everything's okay. Heather, get the life jackets." Well, which is it? Are we boating or floating? Well, that's Nate, a man of contradictions. He loves speed, but he slowed down to be a thoughtful and introspective man. Eat healthy, eat lots of ice cream. Be frugal, own a boat. Work hard, play harder. And that's him always keeping you on your toes and knowing that whatever direction he's going in, he's all in. He did everything to the fullest, whether it was helping a friend or neighbor, working, coaching soccer, or being a great dad, a loving partner, a supportive brother, or a caring son. The day after the cruise, in true Nathan fashion, he had evaluated the situation, clearly determined that getting caught in a storm unawares was not his fault. You see, he had not been able to charge his Apple Watch, which would have alerted him, because his charger wasn't in its usual spot because he had to declutter for Sierra's graduation party. So naturally, he pinned the whole kerfuffle on Sierra. This is when we roll our eyes. On the night before Nathan passed, our sister Megan and I were having a nice group chat about what their kids were up to. Nate shared a picture of a painting party going on at the house involving Heather and some of the girls. After a while, he sent a final picture of Heather's work, a painting she did of Nathan playing paddleball at Long Beach Island last month. I commented that I was amazed at Heather's talents, as she had just also made a pretty spectacular cake for Nathan's birthday earlier in the week. In response, I saw Nate's last words to us: "She's kind of a superhero." As for the children, Skylar, Sierra, and Kyron are like Nathan in many ways: fun-loving, caring, compassionate, inclusive, thoughtful, strong-willed. I don't think I've ever won a debate against any of them. But Nathan made sure that they, like he, were independent, free thinkers, and risk takers. Yes, they will need your help as they transition to a life without the physical presence of their father, but he will always be with them. So many times this past week, they've asked themselves, "What would Dad do? What would Dad want?" We will all miss Nathan terribly, but he has made his mark on our lives. He will always be with us.
My name is Jed Davies. My family moved on to Endicott within days of Nate's family. We, myself, my wife, my two daughters, forged really strong, special, and just amazing relationships with Nate and his family. Ski trips, game nights, impromptu afternoon hangouts. Nate was, and you are, part of our family. I am honored and humbled that Heather asked me to read her eulogy. Nate worked in continuous improvement, and the underlying aspect of that continuous improvement was passion. Nate was passionate about everything. He was passionate about work, he was passionate about friends, he was passionate about Christmas decorations. And he was passionate about his family. He encouraged all of us in the most gracious way possible to push past our comfort zones, to build on our great work, and make it awesome. Nate had a passion for his job and loved his team. He was committed to their success. We recently had a conversation about how he was about to push one of his leaders outside of her comfort zone. He said this in a proud and knowing way because he knew that she was capable of more and he was going to get her there. He would help her get from great to awesome. Of course, we all see this passion and this encouragement most clearly in his children. Recently, I witnessed this a few weeks ago with Skylar. Skylar was asked to speak in church, and she really didn't want to do it. He encouraged her and gave her suggestions, and then she decided to go for it. When she got up to speak, she nailed it. I have never seen him look so proud. I joked with him that his buttons were going to pop off his shirt because his chest was puffed up so much. And I saw the same when Sierra showed her initiative, independence, and maturity with summer jobs. And I saw the same when Kyron started Crew and grew up so quickly. Skylar, Sierra, and Kyron are always awesome. And nothing made Nate prouder than that awesomeness. And he welcomed my daughter Samantha into the fold, and when the six of us were together, the house was full of laughter and fun and awesome. He also brought this encouragement to friends in hard times as well as good. As one example, Nate and his friend Mark were scheduled to do a long bike ride together. However, when the time came, Mark was unusually low. When Nate called to say, "Hey, we still going?" Mark told him he wasn't having a good day and he couldn't do it. But Nate didn't hear no. Instead, he replied, "I'll be there in 30 minutes. Nate rallied Mark for the ride, they talked, and Mark felt better afterwards, back on the road to awesome. For another friend, Nate literally saved him. When he was at a very serious low point in his life, Nate showed up unannounced at his home, arranged for help for him, packed his bag for him, and then when they had to part, Nate called him every 2 hours to make sure he was okay. And Nate's continuous improvement applied to himself as well, with a little help from sibling rivalry. When Nate was going through a difficult time, his sister Megan asked him to run a half marathon with her so he would get back into physical fitness and exercise. She says that in his usual competitive way, Nate then showed up fit and ran faster than she did, even though she had trained much longer. But just before the finish line, Nate slowed down so that his little sister could beat him. Nothing more awesome than that for both of them. For me, these stories of continuous improvement, of Nate's encouragement of those around him to go from great to awesome, are only part of my love for him. It was the way he loved that most impressed me. The way that he was passionate about everything, that he loved everyone, that he recognized and appreciated his blessings. He had a zeal for life that he expressed in each and every relationship that he had, from his children to his siblings and parents, to his team at work, to his neighbors in Fernway and on Endicott, to a friend in need, to any person he met at the restaurant when I left him alone for a minute, to the neighborhood kids who would jump with him on the trampoline. And he showed extraordinary loyalty in each of these relationships. And for me, life with Nate was awesome. We crammed decades worth of memories into a few years. Memories jammed packed with happiness and experiences. Sometimes it was exhausting trying to keep up with Nate, but man, was it worth it. I did everything I could to chronicle the memories. I wrote a journal for each of our first 500 dates. I made photo albums as frequently as I could. We had fun every day. I mean, we took a couch to the dump, and that was fun. We would go grocery shopping, and Nate would throw produce at me, and that was fun. We knew we had something special in our relationship, and we knew that people could see it, and we knew that our relationship inspired happiness in others, too. Nate Hurle, you are my best friend, and I wanted nothing more than to grow old with you. I'm so happy that I found you, and I'm so sad that you're not here anymore, and I'm so thankful for these memories. I think about the motto that we have in the kitchen. God didn't promise days without pain, laughter without sorrow, nor sun without rain, but he did promise strength for the day, comfort for the tears, and light for the way. Nate had his own way of fulfilling that strength, and he expressed that by being passionate about everything. So where do we go from here? How do we honor this great man, this awesome man, who shared so much of himself with us, who wanted so much for us? Just like Nate, we should push ourselves past our comfort zones to love each other harder, to appreciate our blessings more thoroughly and to love life more passionately. And we should remember his gracious way of challenging us, of continuous improvement. When you think you're done, decorating for Christmas, for example, double your efforts. Don't stop at great. Don't even stop at awesome. Remember Nate.
The song You Say by Lauren Daigle is a song that Nate heard many times on the radio while driving with his kids. A lyric that really resonates with us all during this time is, "You say I am strong when I think I am weak." This is a lyric that we all really need to listen to, especially at this time. As we all feel very weak and are questioning how to move forward with life, it is important to know that God gives us strength and provides us all with nothing more than we can handle.
Never. verse, John 13, is a verse that Scowry gave her dad many years ago. It was her dad's birthday. She wrote him a card and actually wrote out many Bible verses. He showed her that card a couple weeks ago, and he still had it. And it was something he actually shared with me those many years ago and was so proud to show me. This verse reads, Jesus replied, "You do not realize now what I am doing, but later you will understand." He later went on to say, "Do you understand what I have done for you?" He asked them. "You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you should also wash one another's feet. I have set you as an example that you should do as I have done for you. Very truly, I tell you, no servant is greater than his master, nor is the messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them."
We're my dad's three kids, if that was. Which you might have heard stories about us, but there's many things that he didn't share and many memories that we still hold so dear to our heart. Dad, a few weeks ago, I was standing in this very spot giving a sermon. I was able to look into the crowd and I was able to see you. You had a huge smile on your face, and I honestly don't think I've ever seen you prouder of me. Today, as I look into the crowd, I don't see you, but I know you're there. And honestly, you're probably just as proud. Dad, you're a superhero. And I'm pretty sure most people here would agree. You made this world a better place, and every person is better for knowing you. There are so many things that you taught me in such a short amount of time. And even this past week, you've still been teaching me lessons that I will never forget. As much as I wish I could extend the amount of time we had together, the amount of time that we did have, there's not a single thing I would change about it. You taught me how to help others and how to love. There's no doubt in my mind you loved us so much, and I know that you know how much we love you. Dad, there were so many big things that you did and big things we did together. But the things that stick out most are the small things. Going on walks together where we would talk about our day. When we were younger, sharing our highs and lows at the dinner table, and we were all talking about ways that we can make our days better. And even helping you cook dinner. At first, I thought you just wanted help because you didn't want to do it, but over time, I realized he just asked us so that way he could spend more time with us. Dad, I know you're home with the Lord. You're walking on streets of gold with nothing but love surrounding you. You can ride your bike forever and go on endless amounts of walks. One day, I know I'll see you again, but I know you'll always be with me in my spirit and in heart. Although it all may not be the way we planned, it is the way God planned. Dad, I love you so very much. Love, Skylar. And then there's a Bible verse that I want to share with you all. It was actually a Bible verse that I said in my sermon a few weeks ago. I used it in a very different way, but I feel like it's appropriate to share now. It's 2 Corinthians 5, verse 17. It says, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come, the old creation is gone, the new is here. Although my dad's body is not here, his new body is in heaven with the Lord and living a better life than he ever could on earth."
Hi, I'm Kyron. So I just want to say I didn't write a normal speech because I'm not normal. So, okay. Okay, so I want to share some fun things I did with my dad. So I wrote down five things. Skiing.
That's my Uncle John, by the way. Skiing with him was so much fun. Being with him, I felt like it was our special thing. We would go down the harder hills together, and I would fly down them without a care in the world, and he would take his time weaving in and out. Then at the bottom of the hills, he would yell at me because that was unsafe, and I could get hurt. And then there's tubing. I didn't know if he was a good driver or a bad driver, but he made me fall off the time, so I think it's a good driver. I can't. And then Marvel movies. Marvel movies was the biggest thing we had in common. We saw every single one in theaters together since Iron Man 3. If we didn't see it in theaters, it didn't count. And I know that he'll be watching all the new ones with me. And then board games. Whenever we had extra time, we'd all, me, Heather, and most of the time not Skylar and Sierra, we'd gather around the table in the, by the door. No, the other place, the better place.
The entryway.
Yeah. And we'd play these weird games that he got that took like 30 minutes to understand how to play them. He always won. I always got annoyed, but it was a lot of fun. And then learning to drive. I'm very grateful he got to teach me how to drive. Thank you for being more patient with me than some other people were. And I was always afraid to crash your car or Heather's car, but I have not. Maybe someday, hopefully not. And I just wanted to also share some of the lessons that he taught me. He taught me how to have fun in life, to make people laugh, and to brighten a room. And I want to be like that. He taught me that I could do fun things without spending money, but to spend money on the things that matter. And he showed me what it means to be a hard worker and put your 110% into everything you did, even if you didn't want to do it. And most importantly, he showed me how to be a good man and a good person. Thank you for being a great dad. Thank you for being my dad. Your memories, lessons, and love will be with me forever. I love you.
Okay, give me a second before I start mine. Okay. Dad, a little over a month ago, you were sitting down writing me a letter for my graduation. Now, I find myself sitting down writing this letter to you, which is something that I never thought about doing. On the morning of July 18th, I was in New York, and I sent you a text asking if we could go to BJ's to buy dryer sheets for college. You answered me saying, I can give you 10 dryer sheets, and I have 5 Tide Pods for you to take. I really had no idea if he was joking or not, so I asked him. The next thing you said was, I will double it because I love you. I still had no idea if he was joking. But that's because that's such a him thing to say. But then I found out that morning he actually went and bought me them already, which is such a him thing to do. He always thought about others, what others needed before they even asked. In times like these, I try to think about what my favorite memories were with you. However, I draw a blank. I think I draw a blank because there are... I think I draw a blank because there's so many fun times that we have shared together. It's impossible to sort through them all and find my favorite ones. I was going through some of your boxes when I found a piece of paper with a drawing on it. The words read, I love you, Coach Dad. Love, Cece. Many people in the community know him as Coach Nate, but I got the privilege of being your daughter, and with that came the ability to call you Coach Dad, even though you told me I shouldn't call you that. This week, I got a text from one of my friends, and part of it said, I can't imagine there being no Coach Nate to inspire the love of soccer to kids like he did to me. You inspired so many people, Dad. As I try replaying memories of you in my head, they all involve soccer. You were my soccer coach for at least 5 years. I'm really just guessing here. I have no idea. For those estimated 5 years of coaching me in the fall, winter, and spring, you would say the same thing to me every single game. Sierra, get off the ground. You're being a baby. Pretty much every game, I would fall down and act like I'm hurt. He would have to come carry me off the field, and I would be fine 10 seconds later. He got so annoyed with me, it made me laugh so hard. This year, during high school, after almost every game, you told me, Sierra, I'm so proud of you for not falling down and not being a baby like you used to be. It always made me laugh. Through being my soccer coach and through the game of soccer, you taught me so many different lessons. You taught me how to be hardworking, responsible, a team player, a leader, and to never give up. Teaching me to never give up kind of backfired on you because every time we got into an argument about something, I would never give up. It always made me laugh so hard seeing you get frustrated with me because I wouldn't change my stance in an argument and it was so easy to mess with you. That was one of the things I loved most about you. One of the words that I thought was already old, and I'm pretty sure we all did, but now we would just want to hear one more time, is smile. You would tell us to smile all the time because you were always taking pictures. Half the time I didn't even smile, I just kept the same face I was making, even if it was me shoving food into my face. The next thing I knew, it would be posted on Facebook. He really did me dirty. Where am I? Oh yeah, but I'm so glad you did because now we have so many pictures to look back on and remember all the fun times we had. Almost every girl dreams of having her dad walk her down the aisle on her wedding day, and the first thing I thought when I heard the news was, who's going to walk me down the aisle now? After sitting in my room for a couple days thinking about that, I thought, you will still be here walking with me even if it's not in physical form, and it brought a smile to my face. In the letter you wrote to me for graduation, you said, I am extremely proud of the person that you have become. You excel whenever you approach something with a positive outlook. I will always be here. My responsibility as a dad doesn't end, it shifts. It shifts to supporting you and your aspirations. Now, your responsibility shifts one more time, Dad. You are still supporting me, but quietly. And now your responsibility is sitting back, watching over me, and seeing me put all the lessons you taught me to use. My responsibility as a daughter now shifts too. I always wanted to make you proud of me, and now my new responsibility is to prove to you that you raised me the right way. You raised me to do everything with my heart, to always lend a helping hand, to smile and laugh at the good times and the bad, and to always cherish the moments we have together. Well, God is watching over us, and now you are too. I wish I could tell you this a million more times to your face, and I know I will be able to again someday, but for now, thank you for giving me the world. With all of my heart, I love you. From your forever, Sierra Mormor.
Jesus, fall on Jesus. sky is dark and pours the rain, then cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus, and live. Oh, and when the love spills over and music fills the night, and when you can't contain your joy and sigh, then dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus.
This is not a second sermon, but the family did ask for me just to give a challenge. Before I do, I know that for the children to stand up and to speak at a service like that is incredibly difficult. And you did a remarkable job. Let us hear a little bit of appreciation, just the heart, love. It is an amazing thing, and I'm not sure which of the three of you have the engineering mind of your dad. There you go. But engineers have a different way of looking at the world. They want things to last. And so this portion I've been asked by the family to share is what I simply called, or what they asked, told me, the next step forward. For this is not just the end. It is in one sense, but it is also a challenge for a new beginning. As the song, Come to Jesus. For some, explore the realm of faith. Explore the possibilities. Explore a relationship with God, our Father, and His Son, Jesus Christ. And find in Him the peace, forgiveness, and the hope, and the joy, and the promise of eternal life. But for some of you, the next step is to do something in memory of Nate. And that might be to, as something, as we say, to pay things forward, to show kindness and an act of love and appreciation towards this family or towards others in Nate's memory. In this way, his memory goes on and touches more hearts and more lives. Life is a precious gift. And this is the challenge for us, no matter where we are in our lives, to cherish what God has given to us and to look ahead and to make a difference. Nate was planning a big bike ride and was working on that. But beyond that, he had other dreams and plans in his life. And just because the last breath that he took seems to be an end, we, as again shared, have this promise of life. That which was shared by family of how that his voice is in your mind and in your heart, and he is with you and will be with you. And for those that worked with him or were acquainted with him through the course of his life, he will continue to challenge you in his example, in his love, and his humor, in the many ways that made him special. For the next step forward is to take that which we have in his memory and invest it towards a future. And in this, our life continues to have a lasting impact. Let us pray. Our Father and our God, Lord, I know that you are here with us. We sense your presence. We pray that as you are the author and giver of life, and I thank you for the memories which have been shared. I know that there are so many here this afternoon that have special thoughts, special moments, special times. Lord, I pray that if given the opportunity, they will share it with family and friends as we will have a chance of fellowship right after the service. For others, that we might take the challenge that he had as a dad or as one who cared about his community and might pay it forward, so to speak, to do something in his memory, in his honor, to make a difference in the lives of others. And in this, we demonstrate the true love that he had for this world. I pray, Lord, that you'll guide us as a people. And I pray, Lord, that you will use us and take care of us. We pray these in Christ's name, we ask. Amen.
The song We Are by Carrie Jobe is a special song to the whole family, but specifically me. It is known as the song that is loved, but we didn't know the name of. This song was sung in church. However, it was the one week where the names of the songs weren't in the little bulletin. Me and Dad were then on a mission to find out what the name of this song was. Soon after figuring out the name, it seemed to be sung every single week in church that I was not there. Dad then turned it into a joke by making fun of me, sending me pictures of the bulletin whenever the song was in it. I would love it if we all could stand up and sing the song which is in the bulletin in honor of Dad.
We are the city on a hill. We are the
May the Lord Jesus Christ and his peace rest upon each and every one. Thanking you, Heavenly Father, for the life of Nate Hurle and for the legacy of his love, his family, and his work, his career, his responsibilities, and his task that he took with great diligence. May they continue on in his memory and his honor. May his children continue to rise up and call them blessed as they have, and that you might use each of us this day to make a difference in our world, that we might be light, examples, and children of love. We pray these things in Christ Jesus' name.